My creepiest cases as a private investigator. The Anna Vandenberg case, written by the General G. I was hired to look into the disappearance of Anna Vandenberg, a middle-aged woman with several adult children. She was last seen on the morning of Saturday, March 9th, when she was spotted running errands around town. She never returned home, and her family couldn't contact her. So they called the police and they filed a missing persons report. When the cops looked into it and found no specific leads, that's when Mrs. Vandenberg's children hired me. As part of my investigation, I was interviewing some of her colleagues at her place of employment. Up next was Matt, who once worked in the same department as her. But more importantly was the fact that he was rumored to have not exactly gotten along with Mrs. Vandenberg. After greeting him, I sat back down in my seat in the conference room, which came with a gorgeous view of the west side of Chicago. Much less appearing were the stale donuts placed in the middle of the polished black table. By this time of the day, they had been picked through so that all that was left were the rejects. After exchanging the usual pleasantries and introducing myself, I asked him the usual benign opening questions before I got down to what I really wanted to know. "Did Anna have any enemies?" I eventually asked him. "You gotta be kidding me," he began with a laugh. "A better question would be, did she have any friends? She had people who tolerated her and pretended to be friendly with her, but I can't imagine anyone who would want to be her friend. She was the poster child of an awful mid-level manager who is just a total brown-noser to people above them. But she acts like royalty to everyone else. On second thought, that's not true because royalty usually brings a certain amount of class. Anna comes up short in that area. She is the living embodiment of, I'd like to see the manager." I had to fight back the urge to laugh because Matt really hit the nail on the head. Anna even had the aggressive perm to go with it. Honestly, I've gotten that sentiment a lot. Not quite as blunt as that, but the idea is there. What else can you tell me? "Well, long after I moved departments, someone told me that whatever poor soul she was dating was cheating on her with some crazy woman. Apparently, the other woman called here one day and threatened her. Apparently, Miss Big Mouth couldn't take the heat and passed out."
"Do you have any idea who she was?" I asked him.
"No, but I sure wish I did. I'd have paid money to see that."
"Does anyone else here know about this?" I asked.
"Oh, I imagine so. If someone told me, I'm sure that they told someone else. Gossip around here is pretty bad under normal circumstances, but now it's gotten insane. I also distinctly remember Anna telling me that her adult daughter hated the guy."
"Really?" I said.
"Yep, I've no idea, but I remember that."
"That's interesting. How did she get her current position?"
"Oh, that's a good question. But you can be sure that it wasn't because of her people skills or her work ethic. So that doesn't leave us with many options. I tend to suspect that she fraternized with people above her. Especially because I heard through the grapevine that her behavior was always the same, regardless of her position. So clearly she didn't just turn into a witch overnight."
"It does seem like she certainly didn't have that many fans at work. So crapping where you eat will certainly do that," I said.
"You got that right. The other thing about her was that she was stupid. When I first met her, she reminded me of the old quote, 'Being powerful is like being a lady. If you have to remind people you are, then you aren't.'"
"Really?" I said.
"Yep, when I first met her, one of the very first things out of her mouth was that I should make sure to observe the precedent when I give someone directions. It was a total Cartman, respect my authority moment, if there ever was one. What a moron.
People with genuine power don't need to make sure that other people observe their rank. That's when I knew that she was nothing more than an insecure woman with absolutely no competence whatsoever. And boy, was I right. I just remembered another thing that she told me right before I quit. She said something about how even her granddaughter thought she had a temper. Kids say the darndest things, don't they? That they do. Honest question, though. Who do you think killed her? I asked him. Man, the rumors around here are endless. It's like some sort of office betting pool or something. The sarcastic answer would be anyone who ever met her. And my sincere answer isn't far from that. I know for a fact that she had far more enemies than friends. Maybe the other woman made good on her threat. Maybe the guy she was with killed her, just to be rid of her. Or maybe she messed with the wrong person and they decided to do something about it. But I can say with total certainty that I am not surprised that this happened. It also wouldn't surprise me if Anna is behind her own disappearance. He paused briefly before continuing. Most of the time, I have a really hard time understanding why people disappear by choice. But this time, I get it. Anna was obviously a miserable person who hated her life. Right before I transferred, she told me that she wasn't unpleasant outside of work and was a calm person otherwise, which I doubt. But you get the point. But if there was anything to be gained by her pretending to be gone, it would be sympathy, money, or some cheap form of power. If that's the case, I don't doubt for a minute that she would do it. I leaned back and said, "Well, thank you, Matt. Is there anything else that you can think of that may be relevant?" "Well, there is one last thing that may help you. Anna reminds me of a cousin of mine. She had the same inability to control herself, you know, foot-and-mouth disease. A barely concealed loathing. Kids with different partners. Someone who's stuck in a perpetual hell of their own making. So, from what I know about my cousin's kids, I would bet money that not even her own kids could stand her. In fact, they probably hate her the most. I know that I sure would." "Well, thanks again. You've been very helpful," I said. Now, the rest of my interviews with Anna's co-workers were uncannily similar to what Matt had said. They weren't quite as colorful, but their statements were virtually interchangeable for their lack of warmth towards the missing woman. Based on what Matt and the others had told me, I thought there was a good chance that Anna was having some personal problems that she wasn't telling people about. People like her surround themselves with flunkies or allies instead of genuine friends, which means that in the case that something bad happens, they aren't about to disclose anything that might contradict the fake image that they've created. Aside from that, the people that she called friends probably couldn't care less. Surrounding yourself with people like that is a lot like being surrounded by piranhas. They're harmless until they see a reason why they don't have to accommodate you anymore. The golden rule of cronies is that the ones cheering someone the loudest will be the first to stab them in the back. While my usual practice when investigating a missing person case is to construct a murder board, I was taking an exception this time because Anna had so many enemies and potential enemies that it was actually pretty sad. And I doubted I could find a board big enough. I had really struck gold with Matt because he was exactly right about Anna's kids. They had all used the same carefully chosen words when speaking about her. It was all very cerebral, like they were giving testimony on the witness stand about someone that they hardly knew, which in all honesty may have been a distinct possibility if it turns out that Anna did something illegal. It was also entirely possible that a blood relative had something to do with her disappearance. I could reasonably rule out her kids since they hired me, but that still left other disgruntled relatives. Moments like this is where my background comes in handy. Having worked as a journalist for a small publication right after college, I know what to look for when interviewing people. The cliche is that you pay attention to not just what the people say, but what they don't say. And while that does have some truth to it, there's a bit more detail to it than that. It's not just what people don't say that I pay attention to. The key is to figure out what people are desperately trying to avoid saying. Because there's usually a good reason that they are trying frantically to refrain from revealing it. So that's my job in a nutshell. Figure out what people are trying really hard to hide and why they're doing it. In this case, Anna's kids were all dancing around the fact that they had mixed feelings about her, at best. Even when a parent is a total monster, the child usually won't flat out say that they hate them. When you factor in the disappearance, odds were good that all of them had some guilt regarding their feelings. Oftentimes, people mistreated or abused as children will spend much of the rest of their lives trying to make sense, to cope with, to treat, or to avenge that hurt. It's only a question about how they go about it. I suspect that hiring me may have been their way of addressing their feelings. They wouldn't be the first ones. There are a lot of times when I have to act a lot like a therapist in the course of an investigation. Anna's children had the same permanently walking on eggshells attitude that I've seen in many people who suffered neglect or abuse as kids. But when they started talking about how they had been getting threatening phone calls, well, that's when I began to feel sorry for them. "Ever since Mom disappeared, we've all been periodically getting creepy calls. Since the numbers keep changing and we're all making a point to answer any call because there's a chance that it may help us get Mom back, we can't exactly block them," the eldest daughter, Katrina, explained. "It almost always starts out with a man's voice who asked if he can talk to Anna. That's how they refer to Mom. Then the call can vary between a mixture of concern or glee that she's gone or something even more ominous. One time I answered and I was told by the caller that they knew where my mom's body was and that we would never find her." When I heard that, I just sat there in silence for a moment before eventually asking a question. "Have you guys all been getting these calls?" All of the kids nodded meekly in agreement. "I'm assuming that you've told the police about it."
"Yes, we have," Katrina continued. "But the calls are coming from random locations with burner phones, so there's not a lot they can do about it."
"The real question is if it's just someone trolling us, or is it someone involved with what happened?" Jonathan said. He was the middle child and the only boy of the three kids. "That's a good question, and I promise you that I'll do everything that I can to get to the bottom of it," I told him. "We appreciate that, Will," he said. "Where there's a will, there's a way, right?" He chuckled half-heartedly at his own joke. "Right," I replied with my own short laugh. "I could use that as a tagline if I start advertising," I said. Now it was time for me to ask what I considered the most important question when interviewing someone who hired me or is closely involved with the case. What do you guys think happened? Not only does this almost always give me something to look into, it's also incredibly important to understand their mindset. Usually when people come to me, it's after they've had plenty of time to sit and think about what has happened. In response, Anna's children sat there silently, clearly wrestling with their own thoughts. "I think that someone finally had enough of Mom and they decided to do something about it," Jonathan offered in a half whisper. I didn't say anything because I could practically hear his brain working. The other key when interviewing is remembering that nowadays most people are beyond uncomfortable with silence and will do whatever they can to fill the void, especially when they're nervous or trying to hide something. This is almost always filled with plenty of useful information, be it about the subject or the interviewee. Will, you must know by now that our mom had plenty of enemies. To be honest, we suspect that there is a lot about her life that we don't know about. She was the kind of person who never speaks about something if she thinks that it will make people think less of her, Will said.
We've thought about this for a long time, Katrina began after her brother had finished. And we think that someone may have been after her and that she was afraid to do anything for whatever reason. Right before Mom disappeared, she seemed so distracted. Like she wasn't all there. As someone who was quite particular about things, this immediately seemed off to us. But every time we tried to ask her about it, she just brushed it off, making one of the usual excuses about being tired or whatever. Our mother was a bully.
The youngest child, Brittany, abruptly spoke up. She was a young woman in her early 20s. Her black hair and sharply contoured features made her the child who most closely resembled Anna.
But like any bully, she was an absolute coward when faced with someone who refused to put up with her and knocked her down a peg. Have you ever seen the movie Gran Torino?
Sure, I have. Why? I asked her.
Remember when he says that sometimes you meet someone you shouldn't mess with? And then immediately introduces himself as that person.
Yeah, I said.
That's what we think happened. Everyone knows what they say about karma. And the sad part is that we can't exactly blame the world for what happened if it's true. In fact, it's kind of amazing that no one did this sooner.
Brittany's last statement hung over the room like dinner that someone had burned in the oven. Her siblings made no effort to speak up, but their faces screamed in agreement. Is it true that you don't like the boyfriend? I eventually asked Katrina.
Oh, sure, but I don't think that he had anything to do with it. He's no Mr. Right, but then again,
Mom wasn't exactly top shelf either, Katrina said. Well, thank you all. I'll get back to you if I have anything new or if I have any further questions, I said. I spent the next week going through the case and all the information that I had without much luck, until I got a phone call from Katrina.
Mom's back,
was all she said. I immediately rushed over to the police station where the kids were with Anna, and the full story finally came out. The three kids were right. Anna had gotten wind of the fact that there was someone after her. According to her, she suspected it was a guy who had a grudge against her because his girlfriend died of alcohol poisoning one night shortly after she lost her job, and he blamed Anna because she had played the key role in getting her fired. Anna also admitted that the girlfriend didn't deserve to be fired, but at the time she didn't see that. But of course, she found out later that the girl's boyfriend had connections to people that you don't want to mess with. At first, she tried to ignore the feeling that she was being watched and that subtle things were out of place. But when does ignoring anything ever work? Not surprisingly, the feeling of being watched only got worse and things started to escalate. She also claimed that the call to work claiming to be the other woman was a setup designed to make her afraid and to let her know that they were watching both her, her friends, and her family. But the worst was yet to come. 2 weeks before Anna disappeared, she got a strange package delivered to her apartment. It was placed right outside her front door, which was a building you could only access with a key, so it wasn't like anyone could just walk in off the street and put it there. Not wasting any time in opening the thick manila envelope, Anna immediately wished she hadn't when she saw the contents. Inside a thick wad of medical gauze was a single human finger. There was an accompanying note that said, "This is how everyone will find you, and if you even think about telling anyone, this is how you'll get visits from your children." Terrified for her children, Anna decided that the safest thing was to try and disappear. After quietly packing things up, she waited until it was time to try and vanish into the night. There was only one tiny problem.
The people that she was trying to hide from were watching her, so they obviously knew what she was up to and where she had gone. This must have been quite amusing, actually. Not surprisingly, they tracked her down and she barely got away. And that's when she decided to call the police and return home. As of right now, Anna is back in her apartment, which the police are keeping an eye on. Which should make her feel better, but then again, they did manage to get into her apartment building at least once before. So maybe she shouldn't stop worrying just yet. If someone really wants to get rid of her, they'll figure a way out to do it. It may look like an accident or something, but if she messes with the wrong people, they'll find some way to make their displeasure known.